have to give an account for himself. There's always this little phrase in Las Vegas that says, they advertise that whatever happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. And it's the idea they want you to come here and they want you to get in trouble. They want you to sin. And they want you to believe that what happens here stays here. And then when you go back home, that no one back home knows what you did here. That what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Like no one else is going to know. And I want you to know that what happens in Vegas stays with you for the rest of your life. What happens here in Vegas, one day you will stand before an almighty God and give an account for what you do here in Vegas or in any other city. We're like that little kid. He was a little boy, and his mama always said, you cannot stay out of the cookie jar. Stay out of the cookie jar. And the little boy, he grabbed a little chair. He went over on by the kitchen, and he put the chair there, and he climbed up on the chair, and there was the cookie jar up on the shelf. And he took the lid off, and then as he reaches in to grab the cookie, he closes his eyes. Because he thinks that if his eyes are closed and he takes the cookie, because he can't see his mama, that his mama can't see him. And that's the way we are with God. Because we can't see God, we think, well, then God can't see us. But make no mistake about it, that one day we will stand before God and we will give an account for every word, every thought, and every deed that we have ever done here on this earth. Number three, the only thing that's going to matter on that day when the Lord Jesus Christ returns, the only thing that will matter is this thought, is Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life? Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. Nothing else is going to matter except have you ever given your life to Jesus Christ? Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your Lord, which means he's your boss, which means he is your king, which means he is your ruler, it means that he's your master. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be what? You might be saved or you will be saved. Oh, you will be saved. And I want you to know that when Jesus Christ returns, nothing else will matter. Except have you ever got to a point in your life where you made Jesus your Lord and your Savior? John 3:36 says, whoever, doesn't matter who you are, whoever believes in the Son has everlasting life. But whoever rejects Jesus Christ, then you will not have eternal life in heaven. Romans 10:13 says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be what? Saved. I want to read that to you again. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be what? Saved. And so if you have ever named Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have nothing else to worry about, really, truly, in this life. Now, if you've never become a Christian, you have a lot to worry about. And I hope that before this day is over, before this night is over, that you will consider giving your heart and life to Jesus Christ. Amen? Now, number four, the question is, when is Jesus coming back? When is he returning? We know he's coming back. We know he's coming back. The Bible says he's coming back. When is he coming back? I want you to write this down. We don't know the exact date, but we can know the season. The Bible says that no one knows the day or the hour, the only God in heaven. Imagine if you knew the exact second, if God had put in the Bible that I'm going to come back on such and such a day. Well, every one of you, right before that date, every one of you would give your life to Christ. Why? Because you'd be scared that you weren't saved. Jesus never wants you to follow him because you're scared. Jesus wants you to follow him because you love him and because you understand that he loves you. The Bible talks about in Matthew 24:8, it's on the screen, it talks about birth pains, that all of these signs are birth pains. Now, every woman knows what a birth pain is. Guys, you think you know what one is, but a woman knows what a birth pain is. Amen, ladies? Yes. A birth pain are these contractions that when a woman is pregnant, she gets pregnant, and for 9 months, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, she's walking around, and my daughter's pregnant right now. My daughter is. And her tummy just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. She's just walking around like, when is this baby coming? Well, there's going to come a time in that woman's life where she starts to have these contractions and these things called birth pains. When she starts to feel that, she'll know, I got to get to the hospital. Why? Because the baby's coming. Now, in the Greek, this word is odin, which means severe agony. Birth pains are like severe agony. Can someone say amen? My sister, I have a sister, when she got pregnant and she was delivering her child, she was in so much pain She turned to her husband, Kurt, and said, Kurt, get a gun and shoot me. Because she wanted out of that misery. But the Bible says that when you see these birth pains, these signs, it's a signal that not that the baby's about to come, but when you start to see these birth pains, you need to know that Jesus is about to return. So here's my fifth point. What are these signs? What are the signs? What are the birth pains? Well, how do we know, not the exact date, but how do we know that we're living in a season of when the Lord Jesus Christ is going to return? Well, I have listed there in your outline. You can see them. You don't have to fill anything in. I've got like 10 of them. The first one are wars and rumors of war. And every day, every news feed in almost every country, on almost every continent, are rumors of wars or actual wars themselves. Famines and earthquakes. I don't know if you know this today, but there are 1 billion. Everybody say billion.
Billion.
1 billion people, they say today, that go to sleep every single night somewhere in the world where they're hungry. No food to eat. They say that 40,000 children die every single day in our world today because they have no food. Earthquakes, man, they just keep happening. In the 1940s, there was only one earthquake that registered over 8.0. In the 1950s, there was only one earthquake that registered over 1.0. In the 70s, there were two earthquakes that registered over 8.0. In the 80s, there were three earthquakes around the world that were larger than 8.0. In the 1990s, there were seven earthquakes that registered over 8.0. In the 2000s, there were 13 earthquakes that averaged over 8.0. And so far in the last few years, there have been 9 of those. 2017, an 8.2 earthquake happened in central Mexico. 365 people died. 2015 in Nepal, there was a 7.8 earthquake. 9,000 people died. In Chile, there was an 8.2 earthquake. In China, 2009, there was a 7.9 earthquake that killed 87,000 people, lost their lives. They're happening, even in Oklahoma, they're having earthquakes. In California, just a couple of weeks ago, there was an earthquake that was so large, it was felt down in San Diego, all the way up to San Francisco, and even here in Las Vegas, one earthquake. Earthquakes are happening all over the world today at greater frequencies. It's just a sign that the Lord Jesus Christ is about to return. Then you have the persecution of Christians. Open Doors Ministries reports that there's more persecution going on against Christians worldwide than there's ever been before. They say that 11 Christians are martyred every day around the world. That 245 million people today on this earth are suffering high levels of persecution. Even in the United States of America today, if you're a Christian, there are many ways that you are being persecuted. Then you have false teachers. Think about all the people that are being deceived by false teachers today. Preachers who are preaching works salvation, that you're saved by doing good works. That's a false doctrine. That's preached by false teachers. Think about the health, wealth, and prosperity preachers who are preaching health, wealth, and prosperity. Think about those who are teaching that Jesus is not the only way to go to heaven, that there's many ways. Think about all the people that have been deceived living on this planet by people who are not preaching the true gospel. The next two I like to look at side by side. An increase of wickedness at the same time that the gospel is being preached around the world. I want you to think about that. Right now in the world, the Bible says in Matthew 24, when you see an increase of wickedness, and the world is changing today. The world is becoming more and more evil. It seems like every day you hear some story that is just hard to even imagine, the evil that's in this world. But it's weird because the same time there's an increase of wickedness, at the exact same time where you see the gospel being preached all around the world. A couple weeks ago I preached at my church and I brought a list on the internet just because of technology. When I was preaching in LA, it was being broadcast. And people were watching from the United States, from Canada, from Australia, from the Philippines, the Netherlands, Germany, Barbados, South Korea, Mexico, New Zealand, Qatar, Singapore, Argentina, Austria, Switzerland, Chile, Colombia, Denmark, France, Ghana, Hong Kong, India, Japan, Malaysia, and Thailand. We're listening to my sermon because of the power of the internet. And I'm just one preacher at one church. Think about all the churches around the world that are broadcasting their services just on the internet, which is free for the most part. I'm not talking about on television or radio. I'm talking about just on the internet. The gospel is being preached more now around the world than ever before. And when you see an increase of wickedness and you see that the gospel is being preached around the world, you know that Jesus is about to return. Yes. Letters G and H, you have increase in technology and people traveling, modern travel. How many of you flew on a plane to get here? Raise your hand if you flew in a plane to get here. How many of you came by car? You drove to Las Vegas. How many of you walked here today? You walked, okay. Israel becoming a nation on May 14th, 1948, in our lifetime. You need to remember that it was in the year 70 AD, the year 70 AD, Jerusalem. If this is Jerusalem, everybody look up here. If this is Jerusalem, Jerusalem was flattened by the Romans, and the Jews were dispersed in the year 70 AD. And in 1948, 2,000 years later, on May 14th, the Bible verse Ezekiel 36:24, "I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land," was fulfilled. Again, another biblical prophecy signaling that the return of Christ is near. The last two quickly. There will be many people scoffing, many people making fun, many people laughing, many people teasing. If you're a Christian, ha, 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 you're a fool. You're silly. That's ridiculous. There is no God. People laughing and mocking and teasing. And the other one is terrible times. Everybody say terrible times. I want to show you this verse in 2 Timothy 3, chapter 3. Stay with me. You're doing a great job. I'm almost to my last point. Can someone say amen? Mark this. Everybody say mark this. There will be terrible times in the water. So when you see these things happening, this is a clue, okay? It's like Manny, when you come fight,